Good afternoon, everybody. I now welcome head of the department, IT Sital Mehan, to start with the session. I welcome our principal and today's speaker, Dr. Suvarna Kulkarni. Ma'am,
Okay, Mahalakshmi, thank you. Very good afternoon. It is my privilege to welcome you all for the Popular Science Lecture organized by Indian Women Scientists Association, supported by BRNS, Department of Atomic Energy, in association with Department of Chemistry, SIES College of Arts, Science and Commerce, Autonomous Science West, Mumbai. At the outset, I welcome our respected principal, Dr. Uma Shankar, our guest speaker, Professor Suvarna Kulkarni from Department of Chemistry, IIT Bombay, Dr. Suparna Kamat, IWSA Joint Secretary, Dr. Shamla Bhardwaj, and other members of IWSA, distinguished invitees, including all my retired teachers from the chemistry department who have joined today. Thank you very much. And all the participants from India and abroad. The topic of the webinar is Inside NMR Spectroscopy. It has a wide range of applications. It is used to study physical, chemical, and biological properties of matter to determine the molecular identity and structure, and also in the field of medicine and diagnostic properties. We are fortunate to have Professor Suvarna Kulkarni with us, who is an internationally renowned expert in the subject. I welcome you all once again. I now request our principal madam, Dr. Uma Shankar, to address the gathering. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. At the outset, it gives me immense pleasure to welcome each one of you on this such a rainy Mumbai day here for this most awaited lecture organized by the Department of Chemistry in collaboration with the Popular, as a part of the Popular Science Lectures. In time and again, our college has been working on this Popular Science Lecture series by other departments too. We find every time when there is a new perspective, new research, new idea that comes up, it has to be shared and enjoyed and enhanced by others. In the field of chemistry especially, when every atom and every molecule that matters in deciding upon so much of diagnosis, so much of work and research happening across, it is essential that when we interact with such kind of reputed scientists who could share their expertise with us, and that would give us a lot of impetus in learning and also understanding a lot of things connected to the subject. I'm so happy and I appreciate all the efforts taken by the department under the headship of Gayatri Sehgal that we are able to hold this kind of a lecture today. I welcome all the dignitaries connected with the organization, the speaker today, Professor Kulkarni, for sparing your valuable time for SIES. I once again welcome each one of you here. I'm sure at the end of it, we shall be enriched by a lot of things, a new understanding, a new perspective, and a new goals to reach as far as research and academia is concerned. Thank you so much. Let's get going.
Thank you, Uma Madam, for your small and short speech, but especially I thank you because you have ventured to come out even through the rain, reach home and started. Thank you so much. Now I request Shamla Bharadwaj Madam to give a short gist about the activities of IWSA. Over to ma'am. Madam, you can share your screen.
Quality. I think there is some. It is taking time. Are you able to see my screen?
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah. You have to open it, ma'am.
It is, yeah. Can you see my screen now?
Yeah, ma'am, we can see it. Can you share the PowerPoint?
Okay, this is the PowerPoint. I'll just make a short presentation about the Indian Women Scientist Association, which is organizing this popular science lecture. And you know, this Indian Women Scientist Association, it is a non-political, non-profit, voluntary organization. It started in 1973, formed by a small group of women scientists. At that time, women scientists were very few, and they felt the need for starting such an association to empower women in science. So there are, today the total membership stands at 2,500. And then we just recently celebrated the 47th anniversary of our beginning. That is in 1973 we started. So this year is the 47th. In another 3 years, we'll be completing 50 years of this association. And you know, the main the building what you see here is the Working Woman Hostel. So this was the first kind of a need for the women who can find a very safe place to stay in Mumbai. So this was the first initiative by the organization, and now we are having 11 branches all over India. You can see the branches in from Amravati to Hyderabad to Nellore, and so all over India. So I'll just briefly tell about our objectives. The main objective of Indian Women Scientist Association is taking science to masses, and then kind of develop a scientific temper in the society, and also understand the problems of women in sciences. And we would like to share our knowledge. Most of our
I think madam has lost her connection.
Yeah, we can't hear anything, George.
What we would, what you would do, I think madam has lost the connection. Meanwhile, I will start, I will start with the introduction of the speaker, and then we will have the session towards the end, if it is possible.
Yes, that's right. Yeah, please go ahead, yeah.
Our today's speaker for today's session, Professor Suvan Kulkarni, is a professor from Indian Institute of Technology, Bombay. Sir has completed his PhD in organic chemistry from the University of Pune in 2001. After completing his PhD, he pursued his postdoctoral research in the laboratory of Professor Shang Shenghung at Academia Sinistia Taipei on chemical synthesis of complex glycans via one-pot protection of sugars. Later on, in 2005, he moved to University of California to work with Professor Jacqueline and was engaged in glycosyl iodide mediated one-pot synthesis of glycolipids. He returned back to India in late 2008 and held a faculty position at IACS Calcutta prior to joining Indian Institute of Technology Bombay in 2009. He rose to the rank of full professor in 2016. His current research interests include devising newer ways for efficient chemical synthesis of complex glycoconjugates implicated in various infectious diseases as well as in treatment of cancer. Professor Suwar was a short-term visiting professor MOST at Taiwan in 2014. Recently, he is working as a council member of RSCWS and also a member of RSC Indian Subcontinent Steering Group Committee. He is recently admitted as a fellow of the Royal Society of Chemistry. He is a recipient of CRSI Bronze Medal for the year 2017. And the Dr. H.C. Srivastava Young Scientist Award in 2016. He is a member of the Editorial Board of Carbohydrate Research. And the most important thing, or which I think is very important, is he has been recently selected by the students for the Best Teacher Award at IIT Bombay, which is a very wonderful achievement. And more important than that, sir had come to our college even in the year 2009 for a seminar, along with two more professors from IIT Mumbai in the year 2009. So thank you, sir. It's a very short biodata sir has sent me. Actually, it's very big. So over to sir for continuing with the next session.
Thank you, Professor George. Can I share my screen now?
Yes, sir. The screen has come, sir.
It has come, right? Can you see the full screen?
Yeah, I can see the full screen, sir. Full screen.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
It's just not moving. Give me 1 second. Maybe something is gone wrong. Yeah, fine. Started moving. Yes. So, So first of all, let me thank Professor George for a very kind introduction. And also I'm very thankful to Professor Shamla Bharadwaj for inviting me to this webinar hosted by SIES College. And as Professor George said, I have very fond memories of SIES College. And I remember Professor Jayanti Madam and visiting her in her cabin, and everyone was so excited. Professor Dr. Gopalan was there with us from RSC. And it was like 4 hours session with Professor Kaliappan, myself, and Sunuj. And I was just a new joinee at that time, so I appreciated that opportunity. So this is my second time, although it's a virtual. And I'm very grateful to SIES College and Professor Shamla Bharadwaj for inviting me. I'm also thankful to all the institute, the departmental functionaries, Uma Madam, Gayatri Madam, and Bhanakshmi Madam, and all the respected faculty members and all the students. So today I was asked to talk on the NMR spectroscopy, which is a very fond topic for me and also for several students. The time, if I have to give a justice to this topic, I teach about 45 lecture long course on NMR spectroscopy in our department. So to compress that, or even half of that in next 1.5 hours is just impossible. But I will try my best to just highlight important points. At the same time, I also don't want to rush through the slides. Therefore, I'll be going slow. So I may not be able to complete all that I wanted to talk today, but that's fine. I think as long as all of us, we understand, that's a great achievement for all of us. I would request all the students to take a notebook and a pen, so that in between, I will give you a few seconds to answer some question, and you can write down that answer, and then I'll tell the answer. So that way you can just see it for yourself how much you have understood the topic. So as initially, it was stated that NMR is very important. So all of you are very much aware of the importance of NMR. What is going to be the outline of my talk is, I'll start with very basic theory of NMR. We'll talk about nuclear spin. Then how NMR really works. What happens at the molecular level that gives us the spectrum. And then we will talk about three factors, chemical shift, we'll talk about multiplicity, and we'll talk about the applications. And in chemical shift, we will talk about delta scale, then why we need internal standard and what kind of solvents we use for NMR, and diamagnetic anisotropy, spin-spin splitting, and coupling constants, and I'll finish up giving you a few applications. And Dr. Shyamala Bharadwaj, she specifically emphasized that I should give a tour of NMR laboratory to the students, but due to the COVID-19, this facility is right now closed. And the operator only comes once a week, so I was not able, but I will surely show you how it looks from inside and how we record the NMR. So to begin, we all know that spectroscopy is a technique which is used to determine the structure of a compound. And I must state at the very outset that because, you know, we are trying this online mode of teaching due to this COVID-19 for the first time, sometimes we lose our audio or video due to internet connectivity. And therefore, I have put in some extra text on the screen so that even if you are not able to hear me, you'll be able to read, and that way you'll be able to keep a track of what is happening. So most techniques, as you know, they are non-destructive except for the mass spectrometry. And all the other spectroscopic techniques such as IR, NMR and UV, we can recover all the sample. And these come under absorption spectroscopy, meaning what we do is we are allowing the matter to absorb energy, and then we measure the amount of light absorbed by the sample and that as a function of wavelength. So we come to know the frequency and wavelength of that absorption. Now, all of you know the types of spectroscopy, and let us see what each spectroscopy has for us. So in IR spectroscopy, we measure the bond vibration frequencies in the molecule. And then we use it for determination of functional groups. Whereas in mass spectrometry, which is a destructive technique, it's not absorption technique, it's a destructive one. We actually fragment a molecule and then we measure their masses. In NMR though, it's a very unique technique where we not only analyze the proton, but we analyze the environment of the hydrogen in that compound. And this gives useful clue as to what kind of functional groups may be present in that molecule. So taken together, if we have IR, NMR mass together, it's very easy for us to determine the structure of a compound. Initially, when we begin our journey into learning spectroscopy, it sounds like Arabic or Japanese, but it's exactly like that. It is like reading, getting to learn a new language. So if we are curious enough, sooner or later, we learn to read that language. And once we start reading, it's easy flying from that point on. And UV, as I mentioned, it uses electronic transition. And to understand why these different type of spectroscopy give us different information, let us take a look at closer look at the electromagnetic spectrum, where you have a radio frequency wave to gamma rays. That's the expanse. That's your complete spectrum. And radio frequency, they are very low energy, high wavelength, whereas gamma rays are short wavelength but very high energy rays. And if you consider, let's say, UV or IR or NMR, if you consider the energy of what is required to the energy of a UV lamp, so that corresponds to somewhere at the bond energy. If you convert this into 10^2 kilojoules per mole, you will know that it is somewhere, it's somewhere less than single bond, but you can excite the electrons. Then when you come to IR, this kind of energy, 10 kilojoules per mole or 1 kilojoules per mole, this kind of energy just allows you to only carry out the molecular vibration and rotation in microwave. And radio frequency, if you see, it is so less. It is, if you really calculate, you will go up to 0.00001 calorie So that's a very, very, so this, I just want to give you a perspective of what energy we are talking about when we are talking of NMR. And this is the same radio frequency, like we hear red FM or other channels on the radio. So the energy of that radiation is very, very low. So we are limited by, because at such a low energy, only nuclear spin transitions are possible. This radiation will not disturb your rotational or electronic levels because the energy is very, very low. This is a very important point to understand. And this is another pictorial view of electromagnetic spectrum. And as you can see in the middle between UV and IR, there's a visible region. There's such a tiny portion of electromagnetic radiation that we are able to see. Our eyes are only susceptible to that particular region of wavelength and frequency. Before that, we have UV, then we have X-rays and gamma rays. And gamma rays are very powerful. They can cause ionization. Whereas if you move to the right side of the visible spectrum, the energy go on decreasing. So you have IR, then microwave, and then you have a radio wave, which is very, very low in energy. It has 10 raised to 2 to 10 raised to 4 meters wavelength. So this is where we are going to focus our attention. And what is NMR and why do we call it NMR? So nuclear magnetic resonance. And if you really try to probe deeper as to why they are calling it nuclear, why they are calling it magnetic, and from where this term resonance is coming about, you will be able to understand the genesis of this technique. It's undoubtedly, it's the most powerful tool available for organic structure determination. And it allows us to detect atomic nuclei and tell us about their environment within the molecule. So for example, we can have a wide variety of nuclei we can study, and the most common ones, and I'll give you a few seconds to write down the most common nuclei. Can you please speak all the other participants?
Hello?
Yeah. Yes, sir, I'm just getting disturbance. Now it is okay. Now it is okay. Sir, can you see my slides? Hello?
Slide is visible.
Okay,
I can see it.
So we were talking about proton and then carbon-13. And then, yes, you're right. We can also have N15, F19, and 31P, and so forth and so on. There are a bunch of NMR active nuclei. So can we take NMR of all nuclei, all of the atoms? The answer is no. So what is common in all these five nuclei shown here? You see they are there. There's an they have odd number of nucleons. So we are going to focus mostly on the proton NMR today. And let us first discuss why this technique is called as nuclear magnetic resonance. So in nuclear magnetic resonance, we have a magnetic field and we are studying nuclei. So it's a nuclear magnetic. Now we just have to figure out what is this term resonance. So in the magnetic field, we keep a sample, and this sample can absorb electromagnetic radiation in the radio frequency region. And the frequency is governed by the characteristic of the sample. And as I mentioned, that absorption is a function of only certain nuclei in the molecule. And what we observe as the NMR, let me begin by showing you the NMR plot. It's a plot of frequencies on x-axis versus peak intensity. So you have frequencies here. As you can see, these are the frequencies shown in parts per million, 1, 1.5, 2, 2.53, so on. And this is the intensity. Right now, we need to find out how do we get to this spectrum. So nuclei, if you imagine any atom, it has a nuclei, and all nuclei, they have a positive charge. So But only in certain nuclei, this charge spins on the nuclear axis and it generates a magnetic dipole along the axis. So only in case of certain nuclei, they have the ability to behave as tiny bar magnets. And the angular momentum of the spinning charge is described by I. It can be described as anything, but they described it as I, spin quantum number, and the value goes from 0, half, 1, 3 by 2, and so on. And its magnitude is described by nuclear magnetic moment, mu. And if you look at this table, you will immediately understand that if you have even combination of atomic mass and atomic number, and a very common element is carbon 612, this has I is equal to 0. And that means this is not magnetically active. But carbon 13 has an odd number of atomic mass. So it has an odd atomic mass. Although it has an even atomic number, it has an odd atomic mass, that is odd number of nucleons. So this is NMR active and it has half integer I value. Similarly, proton, nitrogen 15, P34, F19, they have odd combination, P31, odd combination of nuclei, meaning their atomic number is odd and their atomic mass is odd. So they have a half integer value. Also carbon, oxygen 17 and silicon 929, they have half integer. And if you have even atomic mass and odd atomic number, for example, deuterium, you have an integer value of the I. Now, how does it affect the spin states? So there's a simple formula. Number of spin states is equal to 2ni plus 1 or 2i plus 1. This I is this value. So for example, if you substitute I is equal to 1 for deuterium, you get 3 spin states. So you have a plus 1, minus 1, and 0. Whereas if you substitute this for half for proton or for hydrogen, what you get is 2i plus 1, is 2 multiplied by half plus 1, that is 1, plus 1, that is 2. So you have 2 spin states, plus half and minus half. So please remember that for proton and for carbon 13, we have 2 spin states. And for deuterium, we have 3 spin states. And so when we talk about these nuclei, and I mentioned that they have a spin, and this nuclei with odd atomic number or odd mass number. So we need, as we saw from this slide, that one of them should be odd. So either the mass number should be odd or both can be odd, or atomic number should be odd. So these odd nuclear atomic number or odd mass number nuclei, they have a nuclear spin. And this spin, the spinning charge nucleus generates its own magnetic field and allows that nuclei, a proton in this case, to act as a little magnet. So if this is clear, it will help us to understand that because proton has the I value of half, we have 2 spin states, plus half and minus half, also called as alpha and beta. And these 2 energy states, as this is a lower energy state, alpha, and the beta is a higher energy state where the spin is opposite. So the nucleus can, the nuclei can reside in any of these states when you apply external magnetic field. So this is another schematic you can see. When you apply external magnetic field, the nuclei starts, behaves like a bar magnet, and it tries to orient itself either aligned with the magnetic field or opposing the magnetic field. The state with the alignment, aligned state is lower in energy, whereas when it is opposing, it is higher in energy and it's less stable. So when you apply external magnetic field, the magnetic field is B0, and we are applying a force to the magnet, so it can align or it can oppose the external magnetic field. And these are, again, different schematic. You have alpha spin state and a beta spin state, which is opposing the magnetic field. So this is higher in energy, this is lower in energy. So when your sample, when your nuclei, they are just outside the magnetic field, when there's no magnetic field applied, they are randomly oriented and there's no energy difference between them. The moment you apply magnetic field, the energy level gets split into two levels, the lower energy level, alpha spin state, and the higher energy level, beta spin state. And there's an energy difference between the two, delta E. Of course, I must tell you that we are looking at the radio frequency waves, which inherently have very, very low energy. So this energy difference is extremely less, is very low. But so what makes NMR very difficult or not very easy like recording IR or like recording UV is because we have two factors. One is a low energy of radiation, and second, we are not looking at all the nuclei, because these nuclei get distributed into these two states. And if you recall the Boltzmann distribution, according to Boltzmann distribution, they get distributed and only slightly higher population is there at the ground level. And what do I mean by slightly? If I have to give you numbers, I mean that if you have 2 million nuclei at 300 megahertz machine, you are having only 48 nuclei excess in alpha as compared to beta. So when we apply magnetic field, we are just looking at the population of these 48 nuclei, that they change the spin state. They go from alpha to beta, and the energy that is absorbed is measured, and that is correlated with the frequency of the absorption. So this delta E is very, very important. And we are looking at a very, very minuscule amount of nuclei or of protons. And therefore, we need really powerful electronics to detect this change in our sample. And of course, there's a great advancement in the hardware of NMR, as many of you must be aware. It was invented somewhere in 1960s, and carbon-30 came in picture around 1990s, when people, the mathematicians, invented Fourier transformation. So again, it tells you how interdisciplinary research is important. So NMR, the theory was developed by physicians, and the Fourier transformation was developed by mathematicians, and the end users are the chemists, organic chemists mostly like us, which are the beneficiaries of this field. And all the hardware part is developed by engineers, the electronic computers, and mechanical engineers. So each piece matters and combines together to give us information. So coming back to our subject, so now we are looking at a small population of excess nuclei in the alpha state, which upon giving the energy by magnetic field, they flip to the beta state, that is a higher energy state. And this delta nu, H nu is equal to delta E, is calculated. So we have a hardware that can record the absorbed energy. Also, the beta state relaxes to alpha state. So we also have the hardware that can record the energy absorbed or the energy released. And then we can correlate that energy to frequency. So this is how this technique works. And now this last term, that is resonance. So we have nuclear, we know what is magnetic. So when the alpha state goes to beta state, when the nuclei raises to beta state, we call that it absorbs the energy and it is in resonance when this happens. And that's why the technique is called as nuclear magnetic resonance. Okay, now how do we correlate this? So if you look at the basic Larmor equation of NMR, and I want to be very non-mathematical for this particular talk today, and I'll give you mostly qualitative aspect of the NMR. But still, we cannot avoid some equations, and this is a very basic NMR equation, which tells me that delta E, which is equal to H nu, where H is a Planck's constant, is equal to gamma H B naught by 2 pi. And we can cancel out HH from both sides. So we have nu is equal to gamma B naught by 2 pi, and all of them, they are constant. So gamma is gyromagnetic ratio or gyromagnetic ratio, and it's constant for each nucleus. So this is something that you should keep in mind, that this is a property of a particular nuclei. One, higher the gyromagnetic ratio, much the better is the spin of that particular nuclei. So if you can compare this deuterium carbon 13 and proton, proton has a much better magnetic ability. So you can see it's a 26,753 Gauss for proton, and for carbon 13 it is 1/4, that is 6,728 Gauss, and for deuterium it is 1:6.5 times, so it is 4,107 Gauss. So these are the values, these are constants. And if we substitute, let's say, this value, 26,753, in this equation for gamma, and then we substitute value for magnetic field, and pi is a constant again, we can find out the frequency of that particular machine. So this is what happens if we plug in the values. So for 40,000 Gauss field, we have a 60 megahertz frequency. And again, whenever we refer to a machine frequency, we are basically referring to the frequency of a proton. Let me explain this. So when you say that I have a 300 megahertz machine, what I'm saying is that I have a machine that can operate at 300 megahertz frequency for a proton. The same frequency becomes 1/4 when I record a carbon, because the gyromagnetic ratio is 1/4. So when it goes on this side, it will be divided by 4. So again, if I have a 400 megahertz machine, when I record a carbon, it becomes 100 megahertz. And similarly, this is the same whenever we change the other nuclei. So we don't keep on changing these values. We just change this when we write a manuscript. But when we refer to the machine frequency, basically, we are referring to the frequency of the proton. And so these two things, as I mentioned, one is we are using low energy radio frequency, and we are using we are basically dependent on the population difference due to the Boltzmann distribution. As against when you're taking IR, all the carbon units are available for you to absorb. When you're taking UV, all the double bonds are available. But when you are taking the NMR, only 48 out of 2 million, or if you are taking it on the 500 megahertz, only 81 nuclei in 2 million, they are available for the transition. So that is something to keep in mind. That makes the NMR technique very sensitive, and that's the reason why we need really powerful magnet to even see anything from the proton spectrum. Now let's move on to talk about the next aspect, that is magnetic shielding. And what is magnetic shielding? So if all the protons, they absorb the same amount of energy, for example, if all of them, they absorb the same amount of energy, they will have the same frequency. But that doesn't happen, because then you will just get a single big peak and no information could be obtained. But protons are surrounded by electrons that shield them from the external field. And that makes all the difference. So every proton has a different electronic environment, and that environment shields the proton from the external magnetic field. So these electrons, which are surrounding the proton, they circulate. And they create induced magnetic field. And let me drink some water. That oppose your external magnetic field. So this schematic shows you that, see, when you go to, let's say, if you fly from Delhi to, let's say, Switzerland in a winter, and you have no idea about the winter. So when you reach there, it will be very cold for you, and you will start shivering. By the same time, the person standing on the airport, who is a local native, and he has the idea about the temperature, he will be wearing a big fur coat. So he won't feel cold at all. Similarly, a proton will experience the magnetic field based on the coat of electrons that it has around it. So if you have more number of electrons around the proton, the more shielded it is, these electrons will induce the magnetic field, induced magnetic field, and that magnetic field will oppose. So in effect, the external field is not the same as the effective magnetic field. You will have to subtract the shielding effect from that to get the exact effective field. So this slide again tells you the induced magnetic field. So you can see that the electrons are circulating and they create the induced magnetic field. And this leads to the differential absorption of energy, and this leads to variation in energy, which we call as temperature shift. So this is a very nice slide taken from Wade. You can see at 70,450 MeV, you can see it does not absorb because of the electron. A naked proton may absorb, but the proton having electrons will not absorb. So you'll have to slightly increase 70,458 to 70,459, slight increase in the magnetic field to bring this proton in resonance. And you can see the difference is so subtle. And to know that, you need good electronics and big magnet. And this magnet is many thousand times that of the Earth's magnet. Now let's look at the effect of chemical shift. And this is a very simple molecule, methanol. And you can see that this proton is attached to electron withdrawing oxygen atom. So if you look at the dipole, this proton is less shielded and therefore it needs less amount of energy and therefore it will absorb at a lower field. These protons are attached to carbon, which is less electronegative, and therefore it will absorb at a higher field. It's simple. So basically protons in a different chemical environment, they are shielded by different amounts and therefore they come at different positions. And so far what we discussed is for a given radio frequency in each hydrogen atom, we need a slightly different magnetic field to bring it into the resonance condition, depending on what exactly it is attached to. For example, if you consider the methyl groups, they have a thick electron cloud, they're shielded, so need more amount of energy to excite them and resonate them. And therefore they appear at a high field or upfield region. Whereas the aldehyde proton or aromatic proton, which is not that shielded, comes at the downfield or on the left side of the NMR spectrum. In other words, you can actually, if you can read the NMR properly, you can take it as a useful guide to understand the hydrogen atom's environment in the molecule, and you can really predict the chemical reaction because it's like looking at the electron density map of the compound. You basically get to know where is the electron density indirectly. Okay, let's look at the NMR interpretation part. And NMR signals, as you see, the number of signals tell you how many different kinds of protons are present. Whereas the location of these signals, it shows how shielded or deshielded these protons are. And the intensity of these small tiny lines, the intensity, it shows how many protons of the same number of type, same type of protons, how many are present in each peak. And the splitting shows the neighborhood, how many protons are there in that. So this is a schematic of NMR spectrometer, and if you're following it, you'll see we need a big magnet. We need a sample tube, and the sample tube is special. It looks something like this. Sorry. And it has a rubber cap. So you need to open this. You pour your substance in this about one inch, and then you close it, the cap, and then you have to have put it in the holder, and that holder goes and sits in the NMR machine. And for this, dissolving your sample, you need to use a special solvent, which is a deuterated solvent. This is CDCl3 that you are looking at. So what we need is we need a magnet. We need a special sample tube. We need something to give RF pulse and something to record that pulse. So we need a radio transmitter, radio receiver. And then this detector will look at the difference in the energy, and that will send a signal to the printer, and we will be able to see the NMR spectrum. So this is again a schematic. You can see you need a big magnet. You need a radio transmitter or a receiver. And you have a table far away from the NMR in the room where you have a small computer. This can control the machine. So when you press tick on this console, it will on the control, it will start the flow of nitrogen and hold your sample tube here. And then when you come back, you click down, it will lower it, and the sample tube will go and sit here. And then this transmission of radio frequency will lead to the NMR. And this is the electromagnet, which generates a very powerful magnetic field, which is tens of thousands of times stronger than the Earth's magnetic field. Now, this is a real picture, as you can see, this is a magnet. And here is that computer. Here is your transmitter, radio receiver. And you have to climb up to keep your sample tube here. And then there are, over the last 20, 25 years, there is a race for higher and higher magnetic field. This is the one that we have in our department. It's a 500 megahertz machine. And you can see this tool behind this. You have to climb here and put your sample tube here. But then as you go from 500 to 1,000 megahertz or 1 kilohertz, then things change. So for example, just going from 500 to 700, you need a much bigger magnet. And as you can see here, you have a computer, and this, you have to climb up here through the stairs. And then this is the NMR tube that I just showed you, that this person is inserting in the machine. The tube will go and sit here, and then this lady will be able to record the NMR. This machine is from Birmingham University. This is another picture of how you have to climb up and give the sample here. Then this is another machine that we have. This is 750 megahertz. This is at IIT Bombay. And you can see the staircase. You have to climb from here, stand here, and put here. Well, why do you need such big machines? For ordinary life, you don't need this big machine. A simple machine like 90 megahertz or 100 megahertz or 200 megahertz, 300 megahertz is good enough for small molecules. When you go from small molecules to little bit bigger molecules like carbohydrates, disaccharide, trisaccharide, smaller peptides, you need 500 megahertz for better resolution. Beyond 600 megahertz, you need those machines for proteins and large biomolecules. So this machine, you can take NMR of a big protein, no problem with that. This we have. If you are interested, if you visit sometime, I will take you and show this facility. Now look at this guy. This is a machine which is installed at the Georgia Research Center, Complex Carbohydrate Research Center in Georgia, USA. This is an NMR machine. And you can see, compared with our size, how big it is. This is a 900 megahertz complex machine. And you can go up to 1 gigahertz. So you can see this is so big. This is the highest machine that was installed in 2015 in Japan. And of course, in the last 5 years, many places have the 1GH machine. It's very useful for studying biomolecules. And what is this lady doing here? This is just a small machine. This is a benchtop machine that nowadays you can buy. Because this is great, fantastic. I don't know the price. I know the price of 500 megahertz. When we bought it, it was about 400. It was 4 crore. Then when we bought the 750 megahertz, it was something 11 or 12 crore. This guy must be 25 crore, maybe more. So we cannot afford as a common researcher, but we don't need also. For our research, even if you're working on small molecule, you can afford a benchtop machine. Here you can see this is an NMR tube she's inserting in this, a very small machine, which is an 80 megahertz machine, and this is connected to computer. Of course, the NMR will not be very well resolved. It will be broad, but it's good enough if you are just finding out whether your reaction is happening or not. And you can also go down to even a smaller machine, 45 megahertz machine. Isn't it amazing that you have the whole spectrum? And this machine will cost you something of 30, 40 lakh rupees, which you can probably afford as an institute. And you can record for the practicals, you can record the NMR. And this is a very permanent magnet, small magnet, so there's no danger. So this is the whole range of machines that you have at your disposal. So how NMR works? We have seen that these protons, in our sample, we put them in the tube and then we place them in a magnetic field, whether they are aligned either with the field or against the field. And while they are still in the magnetic field, then you subject them with another radio frequency pulse. And this pulse they can absorb and they change their orientation. So we are providing delta E, and they change their orientation relative to the field, and we can then detect the energy absorbed or given out when the nuclei fall back to the lower energy level. So we need a very sophisticated radio receiver. And we mentioned that if the protons were isolated, you cannot get any information. All of them, they will give you single peak. But in a molecule, they have different chemical environment. So they are partially shielded from the magnetic field, and that's what changes their position with respect to each other. So a proton's position depends on what it is actually attached to. Thus, we have a proton in different environment in a molecule, but we expose them to constant frequency, they absorb the radiation at different magnetic field strength. So originally there were continuous wave technique, and later on, now what we have these days is a free induction decay or Fourier transformation technique. Now, this was a problem for engineers as to how to apply this small radio frequency pulse, because if you imagine your nuclei is spinning and it spins like Bora, like this spinning top. And so it has a net magnetization in the Z axis and no magnetization in X and Y. So now if you give a RF pulse in the Z axis, this tiny pulse you won't be able to record anything. So what they decided is that we should give a pulse in right angles at 90 degrees to the magnetic field, and then place our detector at 90 degrees in the same plane, so that we'll be able to see the change. So very clever design, and without going into much detail, so you have a net magnetization here, you give a pulse at 90 degrees. This is an oscillating pulse. It generates the oscillating field and it keeps the magnetization in the XY plane for a second, for a millisecond, and then it recovers. It goes back in a spiral. We call it a scan. And because it induces phase coherence and leads to resonance. And because our detector is placed at 90 degrees, we can record the NMR. And the relaxation follows. And the next slide, I don't want to give you a lot of details on this, but just remember that there are two types of relaxation. One is a spin lattice or longitudinal relaxation, where the excited protons give away energy to the protons which are not excited, or a transverse relaxation, where the excited protons exchange each other's energy. And this has a great implication in 2D NMR, not relevant for our today's discussion. And also has a great implication in MRI technique. So this is the overview. So you have a pulse sequence, which involves equilibrium in magnetic field. We have a 90 degrees pulse, and there's the acquisition. And then we repeat it. How long we have to repeat till we get a satisfactory signal to noise ratio. Now the information that we get is actually in time domain. So each time a nuclei is excited, you get a free induction decay, and this time domain information is transformed into spectrum by Fourier transformation, mathematical operation, to give us the frequency domain spectrum. Yeah, so there are two techniques. One is a continuous wave technique. This is an old technique, and now it is absolute. What we do in this is we slowly swipe the entire range of all the protons. It takes several minutes, and it is not good for carbon-13. That's why carbon-13 was introduced late, when the pulse technique was introduced. Carbon-13 has, I'm sorry for my voice, something happened to my throat just a few minutes ago. Apologies for that. So 13C has 5600 times less sensitivity than proton. And therefore, you cannot use continuous wave technique. What you have to use is a pulse technique, in which we excite all the nuclei in a sample at a time. That means we give a pulse, and we generate a FID of all of them and see the spectrum. Okay, now because my throat has started troubling me, I will take few pauses and I will start asking you some questions. And those questions, answers you can write for yourself, and then you judge for yourself if you are right. So we need a solvent for NMR. So first question is, what kind of solvent we need? And the obvious answer is that it should contain no proton. It should be inert, low boiling, and inexpensive. Then my next question is that, can we use carbon tetrachloride? And I'll take a pause for you to think about it. Can we use carbon tetrachloride for recording NMR? The answer is yes and no both. See, if you are using a benchtop NMR up to 90 megahertz, or 100 megahertz, you can use carbon tetrachloride because that's a permanent magnet. The moment you switch to electromagnet, there are magnetic field gets fluctuated due to the electricity changes. And because of that, the fluctuation is so much that your NMR spectrum will move and you won't know which peak is coming at which value. And therefore, you need to lock the NMR spectrum. And for that, you need a deuterated solvent. The deuterated solvent, so deuterium will not appear in your proton spectrum. You have, each instrument has a separate channel for deuterium. So we first look at that channel. Use deuterium signal for locking. And then ask the machine to keep looking at that deuterium. So it's like a standard. It's like an invisible standard that calibrates your NMR so that it remains consistently frozen. It doesn't move here and there. Okay. And CD-CL3 is ideal. And in NMR, we always see that we see a peak at 7.26. And we commonly say that it's a peak due to CD-CL3. But actually, it is not a CD-CL3 peak because deuterium will not appear in your proton NMR. Deuterium will not appear. So it's an impurity of proton that is appearing. It's a chloroform impurity that is there in CDCl3 that comes at 7.26. Okay, this is the NMR graph of methanol. And you can see methyl group is upfield and OH is downfield. This side is upfield or higher field. This side is downfield or lower field. Now, in addition to the deuterated solvent, we also need an internal standard which is visible in the spectrum so that we can take the difference and have our delta scale. Now, delta scale is introduced because we can always calculate the value of a particular peak in hertz. But that's inconvenient because that value will change when you change the machine. On a 90 megahertz machine, your one delta will correspond to 90 hertz. Whereas on a 900 megahertz machine, your one delta will correspond to 900 hertz. And therefore, it was felt necessary at that time to introduce a delta scale. And for that, we need an internet standard. And TMS, tetramethyl silane, was a great standard because we add a very, very small amount. And you can see it has 12 protons. They're all equivalent. It's chemically inert. It will not react with your sample, so you can recover it. And silicon is more electropositive than carbon, so it will appear to the right-hand side of all your spectrum. So it won't interfere. So you can safely define TMS signal as a zero, and then remaining signals you can calibrate based on that. So you can introduce your delta scale. Now, once we have a TMS, now we can introduce a delta scale. So what is a chemical shift? A chemical shift is a variation in the position of NMR absorption arising due to electronic shielding and deshielding. And it is measured in parts per million. And I will give a pause here, 10 seconds, 20 seconds pause. Think about it, why delta scale is measured in parts per million. From where this parts per million coming? This is because delta scale, when we do, it's basically a ratio of a shift downfield from TMS in hertz to the total spectrometer frequency in megahertz. So there's a difference of 10 raised to 6 in the denominator, and that's what the 10 raised to 6 is, a million. So it's a parts per million that you see. And therefore, because this is a ratio, the chemical shift, it has the same value regardless of what kind of machine you're using, if you're measuring on, if you're using the delta scale. Okay, and this is an example of what I'm saying. If you see, you have a shift downfield from TMS. So on a 300 megahertz, 60 megahertz machine, see, let's look at 120 hertz, or let's look at 60 hertz. So 60 divided by 60, that's 1. Similarly, if you go to 300 megahertz, 300 hertz divided by 300 megahertz is 1 delta. So that's how this delta scale is invented. And why we should care for higher field spectroscopy? What is the need when we have a 300 megahertz spectrum? How do we care about going to 600 megahertz? As you can see, more stronger magnetic field, it does not change the chemical shift. A chemical shift of 9 remains 9 here. But what changes is that it stretches the spectrum. And therefore, the signals are well resolved. Overlapping signals, they move away from each other. And you see a better resolved spectrum. This is spectrum of methanol again. And now coming back to chemical shift. Chemical shift depends on what it is attached to. So you will see this is a CH3. This CH3 comes at 0.9 typically. Okay. And now you start attaching iodine, bromine, chlorine, oxygen or fluorine to the CH3. Its value changes because the electronegativity value of this X is changing. The chemical shift changes to more downfield, more downfield, more downfield. Also, the number of atoms, and nothing goes beyond TMS unless the compound has a carbon ionic character. So if your carbon here is negatively charged, for example, methyl lithium or Grignard region, as you take an NMR, it will be in the minus region. But typical organic compounds, they all come here in 0 to 10 delta scale. Carboxylic acids go offset, that means beyond 10. From 10 to 12 region. Now, the location depends on how many you attach also, the electron withdrawing rate. For example, methane comes at 0.2, you add one chlorine, it goes to 3. In dichloromethane, it goes to 5.3, and in chloroform, it goes to 7.2. And because this is inductive effect, the inductive effect dies over distance. So, for example, in this bromobutane, first carbon, the protons, they show a shift of 2.5, whereas the last carbon, there is no change, 0.9. So, no change in the last two carbons. So, this is because it is based on the inductive effect. Okay, now my throat is really troubling me, and it has brought me perfectly to a place where I can ask you questions. Now, please take a look at the figure that you see. It's an ethyl isopropyl ketone. I want you to identify the proton that will go most downfield. There are three methyl groups. This. They will be upfield. There's a CH here, and there's a CH2 here. Take a few seconds and think and answer in your notebook which proton goes downfield, CH here or a CH2 here. And you will be surprised that many of you will say CH2, because we think that there are two methyl groups which are giving inductive effect to this CH and shielding to this, but in fact the CH that goes downfield. You can see this from the spectrum, there's the CH that goes downfield. And the reason is, if you compare CH2 with CH, basically we are replacing one H by carbon, and carbon has a higher electron negativity than the proton, and therefore it goes more downfield. Now, this is a very nice way to calculate chemical shift. And chemical shift of proton can be calculated empirically. You start with a value of 0.9 and 1.3 ppm for CH2 and 1.7 for CH group. And then you go on making additions based on what it is attached to. For example, if you have something like carbonyl group or a triple bond attached to your methyl group, you will have to add 1 ppm to this value. If you have a amine or aromatic group or sulfoxide, you will have to attach 1.5. If you have hydroxyl, halogen, something like that, 2 ppm addition, aryloxy 2.5, and fluorine or nitro or ester, it's addition of 3. Please remember some of these values and help me in calculating. Take a few seconds now and just see whether you can use this kind of guide or not. So, methyl group has a value of 0.9. Let's try and find the value of this methyl group, which is attached to carbonyl. So, as I mentioned, if you have a carbonyl, you have to add 1. So, it's 0.9 plus 1, that is 1.9. Very close, it is coming to 2.1. What about DCH2? CH2, if you recall, has a base value of 1.3. And now you have two carbonyls, 1, 2. 1 plus 1.3 plus 2, that is 2.3. And indeed, you have this value for this. And this one, 0.9 plus ester group corresponds to 3. So that goes to 3.7. So more or less, you can calculate and you actually see these values here. So let me ask you this question and give you 20 seconds break. A 30 second break, predict the value for CH2 in this. So you start with a 1.3 for CH2. and then you go on adding. You add 1 for this carbonyl, and then you add 1.5 for the pH. So that will give you 3.8. So in this way, by and large, we can predict. But these are the values. And these values you should know by heart, actually. But with this logic, many of these values are not valid. But let's solve an exercise. I'll give you 2 minutes, 2 to 3 minutes, to tell me the values of all the protons that you see here in the three examples. So as you can see, this methyl group will have a value of about 2. This is a carboxylic acid that goes to 10 to 12. This goes to 3.7. This will go to about 1.7. This will go to 0.9 or 1. Same 0.9. And the double bond, again, remember the CH goes more down to like 6 or 5.9. And this goes to 4.9 CH2. So you will notice that using this logic, some values are not fitting. For example, this, why a triple bond is coming at 2.5, which has a more S character than a double bond, which is coming at 5 to 6. And why pH group is coming at 7.2, and why aldehyde is going so down. And to answer this, we take help of this observation of diamagnetic anisotropy. Now, what is diamagnetic anisotropy? So this nuclei, they behave like bar magnets, and the value of the observation, our observation changes due to their change in their orientation. So it depends on their orientation. For example, if you look at benzene is happy lying perpendicular to the external magnetic field. Then this is a flow of electron perpendicular to the external magnetic field. And this has an induced magnetic field, which is opposing the external magnetic field. Now, if you look at the protons at the rim, the induced field reinforces the external field. And therefore, they appear downfield. So normal value of double bond is 5 to 6. Aromatic compounds they absorb 7 to 8, and that is because of this phenomenon of ring current in aromatic compounds. As again, inside the ring, there is a opposition of the induced magnetic field, external magnetic field, and therefore if the proton is at the center, it will appear afield. Now you would ask, do you have an example of that? Because here you just have protons which are lying outside. Sure enough, yeah, and I must tell you that these values are averages. That means in solution, this benzene molecule goes in any orientation, but the average orientation is perpendicular to the external field. And what we see is the average. And you can see this is an example. These 5 protons are here. This methyl group comes at 2.3. And these protons are coming at 7 to 7.5. Now, to verify the hypothesis, scientists have developed cyclophanes, and you remember Ben Feringa, Stoddard, they got Nobel Prize for catenanes, making molecular machines using compounds like this. And you will see this CH2 now, due to the force geometry, has to stay at the center of this aromatic ring. And look at the chemical shift, it's minus 0.6. that confirms the diamagnetic anisotropy. And if you look at some of the UKL systems like this 18 aniline, you would see two types of protons. The external protons are plus 9.28. The internal protons are minus 2.9. This is again one more proof of the ring current effect. And of course, if you heat it up at 100 degrees and take an NMR, you will see a single peak because they will randomly change their positions and conformation. Now, I'll take again a pause and I want you to observe this NMR and see which peak is where. So you will notice that these five protons, aromatic peaks, are here, 7.2. Where is this methyl ester? It has a peculiar value of 3.8, 3.9 is here. Where is the CH2? 1.3 plus 1 plus 1, that's a 3.3, so it should be here. And this is our benzyl group, CH2, here. And what are these red lines? These red lines are called as integrations. So we just take a ruler and we can calculate from the point where it starts getting horizontal to the point where it has become horizontal. The distance between the two, if we measure, it will be easy for you to understand that if this is 2, this is 3, this is 5. And nowadays the machine will calculate it for you and give it to you. Well, there are electronic effects that one has to be mindful of. So 7.5 is the normal range, but if you attach a nitro group, you will see that these protons go downfield due to the mesomeric withdrawing effect. So it goes to 8.48, fluorine 7.78, aldehyde 8.07, and so on. Quite interestingly, if you have a halo substitution, the fluorinated compounds, we expect that they should show maximum downfield shift. But on the contrary, you will see it's the iodinated compound that shows downfield shift. And that's because size is important. So fluorine is a better mesomeric delocalizing group because of the 2p orbital. So the orbitals are right in shape with the carbon, so the delocalization is more easy. Similarly, if you have electron donating groups such as methyl, the value goes to 7 point something, but a methoxy or a hydroxy or amine group pulls it down upfield to 6.8, 6.6. So if you have a value like this, you're sure that you have a something that is delocalizing in the ring. Okay, now for the alkene, again, the value is 2 as compared to acetonitrile. The value of alkene is much higher. And the same reason can be extended. So you have a pi electron which rotate, generate a secondary electron magnetic field, and that field reinforces the protons. So that's why, due to anisotropy, you get a downfield movement of the protons and they go to 5 to 6. Well, the electronic effects for conjugated systems, the effect is felt at the beta proton, beta carbon. You see that because of this delocalization, this proton comes at 7. Similarly, if the delocalization is a plus M effect, again, the beta carbon has it more and the proton appears to 4.65. And one can have more examples. And in case of DMF, because of this delocalization, you see two signals. Because the delocalization gives to partial double bond character, and these two methyl groups, they are different. They become different due to that. They get different environment, and the chemical shape is through space as well as through bond. Therefore, you see two different chemical shifts. Now, for alkyne, is a drum-like structure. If you consider the p orbitals, of the SP hybridized system, you will have electrons surrounding like a drum. And due to the enhanced magnetic susceptibility factor, which is called as chi, this acetonitrile prefers to stay oriented vertically. And this has now induced field, which is not this proton of acetonitrile, is not in their cone. And therefore, it goes to the normal position and it appears at 2.5. Similarly, the same logic can be given for the aldehyde proton here. That this is getting reinforced by the induced field. And these are the several examples of aldehyde. They typically come from 9 to 10. Only in case of DMF, due to this delocalization, it comes at 8. And there are several aromatic protons. They come near aldehyde. For example, this one, this proton of the nitro dinitrobenzene, or this proton of pyridine, which goes to 8.5. Or the quinoline, isoquinoline, which goes at 9.1. Also, the orthoprotons of the aromatic system, they go more downfield. Again, this is because of the deshielding. So if you consider electrons moving here and the secondary lines of magnetic field will reinforce the orthoprotons. Similarly, the single bond also can show this effect. So in this case of cyclohexane and in sugars, we see this very pronounced. The equatorial protons are more downfield than the actual protons. So this is all about chemical shift. Of course, we need to, last but not least, in chemical shift, we have to think about OH and NH signals. Sorry. They are characteristic. And you can see, you can study hydrogen bonding, effect of hydrogen bonding, by looking at the OH proton. In the entire spectrum, if some signal is shifting due to dilution, that has to be OH or NH. So because of the hydrogen bonding, the proton will be shared by two oxygens or two nitrogen, and therefore it will come downfield. And if it's a solution is dilute, there will be no hydrogen bonding. It will shift to high field, upfield. And another way to know, I will skip this slightly fast, this is NH protons are broad. Another way to know that you have an OH or NH in your molecule is you shake with a little bit of D2O. You take a tube like this, your compound you mix in D2O, or you just add a drop of D2O, shake it, and record the NMR again. Your hydroxyl group will be replaced by a DOD, by deuterium, and it will disappear like Mr. India from your screen. That proves that the signal is coming from NH2 or OH. Carboxylic acids, they go downfield. That's because of their dimerization, and therefore, you can see here it is appearing offset, almost 2 delta below 10. This is a rough chemical shift scale. It takes a few seconds to look at it. You have methyl groups here. Methylene attached to carbonyl here around 2. Then attached to heteroatom around 3 and 4. Then olefin, and aromatic, and aldehyde, and then acid. This you should remember for solving the problems. Now, number of signals is an important factor. And you can see from this spectrum that these are equivalent protons, and this is a separate chemical equivalent proton. So you see two signals for tertiary butyl methyl ether. Now, in this case, you have three types of protons. You have this methyl, these three methyls, and this methylene. So three signals. And as I mentioned to you, the intensity of the signals is based on their integration. And the integration we calculate like this. So many years ago, we used to get a graph paper like this. Now we don't get it. We directly get integration from machine. So here you have two spaces, here you have six spaces. That means the ratio is 1:3. to 1 meter group plus to 3 meter group. This is how we solve. And these are some examples of chemical shift. So you can see this OH is coming at 12. These protons, which are shielded by OME, they are coming at 6.8. And in this, you can see different protons are appearing at different places. So I will take 1 minute break, and I want you to solve this in this few minutes. So you have a molecular formula given here. You have C6H12O6 and four signals you see on the screen. A signal at 1.2, and I will solve this for you, this particular part. So this is one proton, two protons, three protons, six protons. What is the structure? Take 1 or 2 minutes and try to solve it. Now, in a real time scale, in my class, I would give 15 minutes for this. But in our this limited time, it is not possible to give you so much time. So I hope that you will try this problem at home. And I'll give you the structure, but then you can correlate that later on with your thinking. So this is the structure. And this problem is difficult because the real strength of NMR is coupling constant. So in next two sections, over a few minutes, what we are going to see is, what is the multiplicity? How do we get multiplets in NMR? And finally, we'll wrap up with the applications of NMR. So what is the coupling constant? What is splitting? These are the two things that we are going to see over the next 10 minutes. In NMR, it's very rare to get NMR with all the singlets like this. Most of the time, what we see is several multiplets. And these multiplets, they arise because of spin-spin coupling. What is spin-spin coupling? It's like this. The nearby protons, they interact and give multiple peaks. When you are in a classroom and you are listening to your instructor, you have a neighbor. The neighbor may have two states. These two states are either that the neighboring student is very attentive to the teacher or is busy with something else and is not paying any attention. So a positive state and a negative state, and both these states will affect you. If the neighbor is paying more attention, you will be also very focused. If the neighbor is not paying attention, you will be distracted. So you will see two states of the neighbor, and therefore you will feel both these states. This is exactly what happens to the nuclei. So let me tell you about spin-spin splitting in general first. First of all, equivalent protons will not split each other. For example, a CH3 group, it will appear as a singlet. Chemically and magnetically equivalent protons, they don't split each other. So only the non-equivalent protons on adjacent carbons or the same carbon have magnetic field that may align with or oppose with the external field. And this difference causes the proton to absorb slightly downfield or upfield. And I will show you this with a picture so that it is more easier to understand. So it is important to know that coupling is a through bond effect. It's not a through specific. It's an electronic relay between two atoms or three atoms or four atoms or sometime even longer. And coupling constant, when we say, is the frequency difference between the peaks of the multiplet signals. So it is proportional to the effectiveness of the coupling. Meaning, if I say is a large coupling constant means the large coupling means it's a more effective coupling. So between a cis double bond and a trans double bond, the coupling is 10 and 16. 16 is more effective. And these couplings are represented with by J, italic J. So a coupling between HA and HB is represented as italic J, AB. And it rarely exceeds 20 Hz. So we directly look at the two peaks and measure the difference between them in Hz straight away. We don't go for PPM because it rarely exceeds 20 Hz. But chemical shift can go up to 6,000 Hz on a 600 machine. So this will be a carboxylic acid proton on a 600 megahertz machine. And therefore, we prefer to express it in delta or PPM. And thereby, by doing this, what we get is coupling constants and chemical shift. Both are independent of the machine. So regardless of the machine you choose, you're going to get the same chemical shift and same coupling constant. And now let's look at this particular compound, 112-tribromoethane. Now this proton is going to give you a triplet because of these two protons. And these two protons, they get a doublet because of this neighbor. How this happens? So this is a vicinal coupling, example of a vicinal coupling, meaning in a vicinity. So equivalent protons don't split each other, first of all. Then the protons which are bonded to the same carbon, they split each other if they are non-equivalent. For example, diastereotopic protons. Otherwise, no. And protons on adjacent carbons normal will split each other. And typically, if they are separated by four or more bonds, that will not happen. And when that happens, it happens, rarely happens. We call it a W coupling or a long-range coupling. For example, this proton talking to this proton is a long-range coupling. Typically, this proton will only talk with this proton. And this will talk with this and this. Okay. Now, coming back to the point of multiplicity, and this is the second last point of our talk of today's lecture. So it's important to note that the lines that you see in the NMR, they're not related to the number of protons in that group, but they are related to the number of protons in the neighboring groups, that is N. That means, what, how many are next door? This is the question. It is what you see that matters, not what you are. So multiplicity is N plus 1. So if you see 5 protons, you just add 5 plus 1, so you'll see a sixth state, if it is a first order multiplet. So let's find out why we see the difference. And I think let me check the time. It's 4:37. I should be able to wrap up in another 10-15 minutes max. So if you look at this particular green proton, right, this two protons HB, they experience, so this green proton will have two states, either reinforcing the field or opposing the field. And this particular proton experiences both the states. So if it is reinforcing, the HA signal, the HB signal moves downfield. If it is, in this case, it is opposing. So this will shield, cause shielding, and this will make this signal move upfield. So the original signal that should come here, it actually splits into a doublet. So basically, you feel the alignment of the neighbor. And there are two possibilities. One, aligned with the field or opposing the field. And based on that, you've experienced two chemical shifts, therefore the signal split. And then these, both these possibilities are equal, therefore the ratio is 1:1 of a doublet. Now, if you look at the triplet, if you look at this other proton, what is happening? This proton has two hydrogens next door. So these two can both be opposing. In that case, the signal will shift upfield, or both be aligning, in that case the signal will shift downfield, or one aligned, one opposing, one aligned, one opposing. And these are two possibilities and one possibility each. So the intensity ratio is 1:2:1. In this case, the effect is cancelled, so the signal stays at the same value and you see a triplet, 1:2:1. And similarly, for quartet, if you have three neighbors, you see a quartet, and the intensity ratio is 1:3:3:1. And this is because you have these three nucleon with three protons. Three can be opposing, three can be aligning, and then two are opposing, one aligning, one opposing, two aligning, giving you, let me show you that figure here, giving you a quartet 1:3:3:1. This is 1:2:1, this is 1:1. Okay, now this will happen only in case of the first order multiplet. Now, what is the first order multiplet? A first order multiplet in a common man's language is a well separated multiplet, meaning the difference in the chemical shift and coupling constant ratio will be larger than about 8. So they are well separated peaks. In such peaks, these peaks are centrosymmetric, and the multiplicity can be gauged by the number of protons, non-equivalent protons, which are present next door. So if you have 6 protons, for example, isopropyl group, the proton, the CH proton will have 6 protons next door, so you get a septate for that, 6+1. And the intensity you can work out from drawing a Pascal triangle. So if you have, let's say, a quartet, the intensity ratio is 1:3:3:1, whereas if you have a quintet, the ratio is 1:4:6:4:1. This you don't need to mug up. You can just draw a Pascal triangle, and this will give you intensities, provided that you are dealing with the first order multiplet. And these are the values for typical values for coupling constants. This you should know. So this is the typical value, 7 hertz for a vicinal proton, and cis and trans, as you can see, 10 hertz for cis, 16 or 15 for trans. Geminal is 2 hertz. Ortho coupling in case of aromatic is 8 hertz. Meta is a long range, W coupling, you can see it's 2 hertz. Allylic coupling, this coupling is actually wrong. This is 7 hertz. I'm talking about the allylic coupling, which is 3 hertz. And why do you see a difference between the cis and trans? It's because in case of trans, there is a much better electronic relay, and therefore the value is higher. And you can find out a coupling constant by looking at the dihedral angle. Now, for a dihedral angle, to know, understand the concept of dihedral angle, you can pick up a book and open it. It will look like this. So this is a dihedral angle. This rim and this rim, the angle between the book is a dihedral angle. So if you are looking at this C2H2 molecule, the angle between these two, CH, is a dihedral angle. And Carl Fuller has very nicely given the relationship between vicinal coupling constant and the dihedral angle. So from Carter's equation, you see if the angle is 90 degrees, the coupling constant is 0. But if the angle is 0, that means if it is cis, coupling constant is 8. If the angle is 180, that means anti-periplanar, the coupling constant is more than 10. So this is a very nice empirical correlation that Carplus has given. And these are some examples of long-range coupling constants. These are very strange, very rare. Therefore, I put it here. Typically, the long-range coupling constants are of the order of 2 and 3 hertz. Okay, this brings me to the last part of my talk, last 5 minutes. What are the applications of NMR? So first of all, structural elucidation of unknown compounds. Then you can confirm the synthetic intermediates and final products. Then you can estimate the percentage impurity. And one can actually look at the 3D structure of biomolecules in nature by looking at the high field NMR, by 2D NMR, 3D NMR studies. And MRI Madam explained that you can use it for medical investigation. And MRI is basically nothing but NMR, but people are scared of the word nuclear in the West. So this is basically nuclear magnetic resonance imaging. But this is changed because of the scare with the word nuclear. Because people perceive that when you say nuclear, it must be radioactive. and therefore that word was removed and we used the word magnetic resonance imaging for MRI. How does it work? You can look up on the internet and you will see, but I will give you in a nutshell, I will tell you what we do. We basically place our body inside the machine, and some people are claustrophobic. For them, now we have the open systems, which are not like a cylinder, but they're open. I must give you a word of caution that all these techniques, they involve very big magnets. And you cannot take any material that is magnetically active. You cannot have your keys in your pocket. You cannot have your wallet in your pocket. You should not have any metallic implants in your body. Also, you should not carry your credit cards or a card having magnetic data. Everything will get erased. They're really, really powerful magnets. And so what we do, but they do little harm to our body. Imagine when we hit our body with X-ray. X-ray is a very, very powerful, damaging radiation. But less than gamma rays, of course. But then if you look at NMR, it's very low energy. It won't do any harm to your body. So what it does, we give a sweep and it will align all the protons in your body in one direction. And then we will stop and it will come back to its position. So the energy absorbed can be detected in different sections of your tissues. So water will give a very strong signal in your body, and your fat will give a strong signal. So what we do is we do a subtraction spectrum. We have a signal for water, we have a signal for lipid or fat, and we delete that. And then if something remains, then it's tumor, and you will be able to see tumors like this very easily detected by using NMR technique. This MRI scan of human brain, you can see a metastatic tumor in one hemisphere. And this is not a picture of lion. This is our body. It's a pelvic region. And you can see very clear imaging by using NMR technique. I think I must stop here because of the limitation in time. And I hope in today's talk, I was able to convey to you that NMR is a very, very important technique and it's a powerful tool. And you can use this technique to do structure elucidation and the fundamentals of NMR. And if you have any questions, I'll be very happy to answer.
Thank you, sir, for a very enchanting lecture on NMR. It is like a story you have taken, and I think all the students will highly appreciate it. Thank you so much, sir. Now we will have the question answer session. So over to the question answer team for the questions in the chat box.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
There's a question by the participant. Can you explain why very few nuclei remain in alpha spin state while maximum nuclei are in beta spin state?
I guess I don't understand the question. Because if you look at any nuclei, as long as there's the alpha and beta question arise if you have an external magnetic field.
And also if the you place it is there on the screen.
Sorry. Sorry, sir. Can you please?
So screen, I think it's not visible. Screen sharing is not visible, Tiwari, sir. Okay.
Yeah, I'm not able to see. But I think there is some confusion here for the student. I think the alpha beta terminology comes in picture when we apply the external magnetic field, and in that always if you are asking why slightly more population is there in alpha state than in beta state, and that's due to Boltzmann distribution. And one can mathematically verify that the ratio comes to, the ratio of n beta to n alpha comes to 0.999919. So there's a derivation, one can mathematically prove it. I don't know if I answered the question, but that's what I think.
So, second question is, can we take NMR without solvent?
Yes, we can. We need a probe called a solid state probe. So, if you have a compound which is crystalline or which is solid, and you want to study the crystalline properties of that solid material, and you are not able to dissolve that, you can have a solid state probe and you can measure. You don't need a solvent. For example, this is very widely used in material science. And you don't have to have a different machine. The same machine has a probe for liquid, has a probe for solid.
So third question is from the participant.
Yeah, please. Hello?
If the sample is liquid, then will it be possible to take NMR?
If the sample is liquid, then yes. Yes, of course. I mean, most of the time in organic synthesis we do, our 95% of the samples are liquid. Very rarely we get a solid compound. And liquid, you can dissolve it in the another solvent like this CdCl3, this bottle. This is basically deuterated chloroform. So chloroform will dissolve your compound even if it is liquid. It should be homogeneous. It should not have any particles. It should be clear. And if you have some something in it, you have to basically filter it and take it. But yes, the answer to your question is yes.
So another question by the participant.
Yes. Okay.
As
magnetization is inverse, I could read it. As magnetization is inverse proportional to Bia.
Can we please, so this question tell what cryogenic agent is used in a machine?
Yeah. So, because as you know, these are all very strong electromagnets. And the electronic magnets there, they get disturbed by electric signal. The magnetic signal gets disturbed by electric signal. And cryoprobe, what it does is basically cuts off all the inconsistency due to electrical fluctuation. So it makes your spectrum beautiful by lowering down the temperature. By avoiding the interference of the electrical field.
Okay,
I see some more questions in the chat box.
So one more question.
Yes. Yes, sir, please.
Can you just emphasize on locking and shimming?
This is a beautiful question. So shim is a mechanical part inside a machine. There are up to 6 to 8 shims in a machine. They are mechanical parts. Locking is a process. So when you are using a magnetic field of 300 megahertz or 600 megahertz, these are powerful electromagnets that I showed you actually, pictures. And they are prone to fluctuation due to electrical field. Now, later on I showed you that, let's say if you are working on a 600 megahertz machine, try to visualize this. Then your 1 delta is equal to 600 hertz. And your 10 delta, your entire spectrum is 0 to 6,000 hertz. Now, if you just try to visualize how small it is in 600 megahertz. Your machine frequency is 600 megahertz and your spectrum frequency is just 6000 hertz. So if there's a little bit of fluctuation, your entire spectrum will go out of window and you won't see anything on your screen. So how do you stabilize this? So what we do, we put a bug. So basically we add a deuterium in our sample. And this deuterium, we have another separate channel. So first thing we do is we look at the deuterium and we log that signal and say, okay, deuterium, you stay here. And we ask that channel to keep looking at the deuterium in the solution, which is very simple. It's just one signal. So it's like, even if the whole thing moves, both are moving. So the relative frame stays the same. You're getting my point. So basically, this is called as locking of the field. And shimming, what happens sometimes when you take the NMR, your baseline is not correct. It's out of phase. So the peak starts and then it goes out of phase. To bring it in phase, we need to use shims. And we rotate those shims in order to do the baseline correction and bring it in the same plane. So these are very important aspects of NMR, locking and shimming. Practically.
Thank you, sir. Sir, another question. The NMR is more efficient for solid or liquid sample, or it is irrespective of, or does not depend on state of the sample? The NMR is more efficient either for solid or liquid.
No, I understand.
Or does not depend on the physical state of the sample.
It does not depend. It should be soluble. It depends on the solubility of the sample. If your sample, regardless of whether it's a solid or liquid, if it is soluble, it's just the same. But I must tell you a very small difference in this. If you have a compound which has a hydroxyl group, and if your compound is solid, you are able to see splitting due to hydroxyl group. If your compound is liquid, you won't see it. The relaxation rate is faster. But these are very tiny differences. There is, to answer your question, there is not much difference. You can just dissolve it. If it dissolves, you can take the NMR. No, the TMS
doesn't. Can TMS show doublet or any shoulder peak?
No, it should not. It's just one peak. Then there is another impurity of silicon in it. Maybe it's a trimethylsilane or a dimethylsilane or some impurity. Well, these are really nice questions. And if you have more questions, please let me know.
Anyone who has doubt can type in the chat box.
I'm just typing my email address. In case if you are not able to find a question now, you can just write to me later on.
So thank you very much for your valuable suggestions and discussing the very intricacies of NMR. I'll ask now Joshua, request Joshua to take the session.
Thank you, sir, for the explanation given to all the questions. I request Shamla ma'am to continue a session which stopped due to internet problem. Over to Shamla ma'am for screen share.
Yeah, I think I need to remove my screen, right? Yeah, wait a minute. Oh, you can remove that, yes.
Due to some internet problem, my presentation went off, I think. I'll just complete it in a few minutes. I would like to tell about our... So this is... I'll share my screen. Can you see me?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, ma'am. Please continue. Please continue.
Yeah, there was some other talk, I think. So I just told you before about IFSA. I think this you must have heard it. That it is a Indian Women Scientists Association is a non-political, non-profit, voluntary social organization, and we have so any. Information. This is our website. You can see not our website, which is there in the screen. So you will know more about our activities here. But I just want to briefly tell. I think this also I was able to tell. I think that our main objective is taking science to masses and developing. So this kind of talk today we had. I must thank. Professor Kulkarni for a very enchanting talk today. This is to develop scientific temper in mainly among the students, that when they hear from an expert like Professor Kulkarni, they get a wider perspective and then they will take more interest in the scientific career. That is the aim of IFSA. And we have many other activities, mainly basically two arms of IFSA. One is community welfare projects, the other is a science education programs. So among community welfare, we have a working woman hostel, as I showed you in the first slide.
There was one more thing said, that was a hockey poster, Gula competition.
We have several community projects of IFSA. That is, we give a safe haven to the working woman. We have a healthcare center. We have a cancer detection camps regularly we conduct. Then health checkups for many poor people and needy. And then we have a library which all the students use, and we give scholarship for the students to encourage them to take up science as their career. And this daycare and nursery are very important because many of the working women are not able to continue because they have to take care of the children. So we step in and take care of their needs of taking care of the children when they are in their work. Among the science education programs, we have Science Nurture Initiative, which means we teach 6th, 7th and 8th standard students science subjects of the nearby schools who are somewhat poor in their background, so that they are able to, we give them free education and help them to understand the scientific principles in a better way. This we do voluntarily. And then we hold workshops for school students and also teachers, school teachers, college teachers. There is Sunday Science Club to ignite the imagination of young minds. Then we regularly hold scientific conferences. We just once in 3 years we have a national conference, and recently we had in Hyderabad a conference, national level conference. Then popular science talk is the one which we had today. We heard from Professor Kulkarni on about NMR, and I'm sure most of the students must have enjoyed it. Then we have been holding refresher courses for the college teachers because this is very important for them to upgrade their knowledge. We hold science exhibitions for the school and college students, and we have a learning garden in our premises. So I invite all of you, after all these COVID problems are over, you can come and visit our headquarters at Kashi. You will come to know our various activities, also enjoy our learning garden and know more about the environment and other activities. Then this is just a list of what we had recently held, the refresher courses on biology, on physics, bioinformatics, physical chemistry, various workshops on lasers, then neurosciences. So all these are for the benefit of the students and teachers, which are then I come to this, the many of the women who are hello, can you hear me? Am I audible?
No.
We can hear you.
Okay. So, see, we hold a diploma in early childhood care education. This is affiliated to SNDT University. And this course we have been carrying on for the last 25 years. So many of the women who have just 12th pass can join this course. They get their certificate from the university. And after they get this, after the course, they get 100% placement as, you know, kind of teachers in nursery schools and help the nursery children. So on this kind of slide, I will share with some of you, so that you know you can contact, and means you can pass on this message to the women who may be interested in joining this course. Then recently we have started a kind of a collaboration with Drishti, which is another NGO. This is to understand the children's learning disabilities. There are children with, you know, attention deficiency and hyperactivity, some children, and some children have their learning disability like dyslexia and all. So there is a foundation course which we are planning to hold online, and this is a 1 month course. So if you try to understand the problems of these childs, you can help such children, and this is kind of a societal kind of help which we can do to the children who have this learning disability. So continuing this course, we also will have a course of 3 months for a shadow teacher training. So once you undergo this 3 months shadow teacher training, you will be able to handle these learning disability students. You will either get a job for taking care of the children, or you can help many in your neighborhood who have these problems. So this is the eligibility is only 12th standard for all this. So those of means you can just pass on this information to the persons whom you know who want to know about these courses, so, and then you know we can benefit the society, but by doing this kind of help to the children, to the needy students, and all those people whom we can help. So this is all I want to tell about our IFSA, and I thank SIS for hosting this lecture, and thank Professor Kulkarni for a wonderful talk. And then I hand over to the SIS college for further continuing this program. Yeah. Stop.
Thank you, madam. Shekhar Iyer sir to give the word of thanks.
Thank you, Josh. This screen is not seen. Anyway, on behalf of SIA, I'm here to present a formal vote of thanks. First and foremost, Professor Suvarna Kulkarni, thank you so much, sir, because you have made such an exhaustive topic like NMR, and you have taken all your the complete expertise to actually bring this topic to the level of the students and participants at the given time possible, in spite of having a little bit of, you know, you had a little bit of throat irritation and all that, but you went through the whole thing, and I believe everybody have gained a lot from this today's lecture, even though it was a short one, and you have done the best, you have delivered the best what is required at this point of time. And I would also take this opportunity to thank Dr. Shamla Bharadwaj, who in support with SIS College has really taken a lot of pains to bring up this lecture. We had totally 315 participants who had registered, 80 faculty, 235 students. Places apart from Mumbai were Ernakulam, Ahmedabad, Cochin, Nagpur, Amgaon, Amravati, Bandardra, Lakhandur, Wardha. Now the institutes apart from SIS, which were there in this webinar, were St. Xavier's, IWSM members, of course, Institute of Science, Mumbai and Nagpur, IIT, St. Thomas College, UC College, Alua, Mumbai University, KBP, Vashi, Vase Kelkar College, Sate, with just course to show the popularity of this lecture which has been delivered, and the right, you know, the right logo, you can say, popular science lecture. So, and of course, a big thanks to the SIS management, to our principal, who have always been supportive for these lectures and for any such venture with respect to the chemistry department, and also all my colleagues and my retired colleagues who are there today, Jayanti Madam, Uma Palkar Madam. Padmanabhan sir is there, George?
Sir is not joined, sir.
Okay, okay. No, he was sir, okay. And Vinod Menon sir, the vice principal, physics department.
Dr. Bhaskar Education has also joined.
Oh, Dr. Bhaskar, yeah, we have had an excellent session with him in laboratory safety practices and intellectual property rights. So it's a great gathering here today. So once again, on behalf of everyone, thanks a lot for giving this platform to present the vote of thanks, and goodbye. Thank you.
Manashmi, can you share the feedback link for the participants?
Yeah. Yes. Participants, please submit the feedback link. It will be open for another half an hour. And I'm just displaying the QR code. So those who can't click on the link from the chat box can go through the QR code. Just a minute. I'll just share my screen. Just a minute. Okay.
Hello, George sir and Mahalakshmi madam. Can I go now?
Yeah, thank you. Hello. So much, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you. And if you meet Jayanti madam, please thank her. And please convey my best regards to her.
Yeah.
And tell her that we still remember. When I came for the first time, she has got, she prepared idli for all the participants herself, and she had got for us.
So,
very unique. Yes.
Sir, she was attending a lecture, but okay. Wi-Fi was not working in the house. I think she must have left for the last part.
Right. So please tell her my regards. And Dr. Shamla Bharadwaj, so thank you so much again for
thank you for a nice lecture, and I'm happy that it reached so many students.
Pleasure.
And I am sure many of them would have been kind of benefited by this. Thank you so much. I'll contact you for more.
Thank you.
In future.
Thank you, ma'am.
So, Mahalak, I'll be leaving this. Okay?
Yes. Yes.
I'm also leaving the... Thank you all so much. You all took really great pains and...